next what we are going to have is Satya Sodhani. Actually, I'm very quite sure you all will agree. Nowhere in IME, there is a CME without any invitation, doctors gather in a place by 4:30 last Sunday of every month, and we have really conducted the same thing. I mean, RTCP sensitization program for practitioner at Pallava Hospital. And it was a very wonderful program, I think, the coordinator, Dr. Ramanavar will agree. But recently, he called me one day in a state council meeting. He told, your branch is a blacklisted branch in all over India, because that is where red tapism comes. And today we are going to learn because of that again about TB. So many formalities are there which they could not give, the bills, the way of developing, putting a what you call banner, and the vouchers, and the way it should be conducted, everything which we have not done. National Tuberculosis Control Program, sensitization program for medical practitioners. And Dr. Ram Manohar Rao is graduate from Madras Medical College in 1979. He passed the MD Venerology course also from the same college in 1989 and was judged as the best outgoing student. Has been practicing a family physician and consultant in STD and HIV AIDS for almost 3 decades. Has been joint secretary in and vice president of state branch of IMA Tamil Nadu. Also, he belongs to IMA Chennai South. Has been National Secretary and National President of Indian Association for the Study of STD and AIDS. Has been the Secretary of the Southeast Asia Pacific Region of International Union Against Sexually Transmitted Infection. So we have a really great honor to have him here. The other speaker is Dr. Vinod Kumar. Please come forward, sir. He is currently Senior Assistant Professor in Department of Thoracic Medicine in MMC. Also consultant at Apollo First Med Hospital, did UG at Mohan Kumar Mangalam Medical College, Salem from 1993-99, joined government service in 99, PG from JIPMER 2003-06, worked in RTCP from grassroots level, has represented Tamil Nadu for last 10 years at National Task Force for Tuberculosis. So I hand over the mic to you, sir. We will learn from you, sir.
We all know the healthcare services in India is provided by various sectors, the government sector and the private sector, via the CGHS scheme. And as we all know, that tuberculosis is managed by everyone. So, for effective control of this disease, the common areas is that all sectors should join hands and work towards a common goal. And this tuberculosis control program is an example of a private public mix. And it is a good example of the collaboration between the various health sectors. All sectors have their own pros and cons, and the problem with our government sector is accessibility. Most of the patients, they are accessible to us only in the morning hours. When they are free, we are not there. But the strength of the private sector lies in your accessibility and the flexibility. So they can walk into your clinic at 9 o'clock in the night, and you are always there. And if you join the program, it will be a valuable help for us. So coming to the basic facts on tuberculosis, as we all know, tuberculosis is caused by mycobacterial tuberculosis, and 85% of tuberculosis is the pulmonary tuberculosis. It's transmitted by airborne transmission, and every sputum positive patient can infect 10 to 15 people in a year. 83% of transmission of tuberculosis is by the sputum positive. That is why the program has given the bonus of the program is for controlling these sputum positive cases, which is mainly responsible for the transmission of tuberculosis. And the best way to control tuberculosis is by early detection and treatment. So coming to the magnitude of the problem of tuberculosis, so globally there are 9.4 million new cases of tuberculosis every year, and of which about 4 million are sputum positive. And 78% of tuberculosis is in the high prevalence, high burden countries, in 22 high burden countries. India contributes to about 21% of the global prevalence of tuberculosis. In India, the prevalence is about in India, about 40% of the population is infected with tuberculosis, and out of these 40%, there is a 10% lifetime risk of tuberculosis in the absence of HIV. So in the presence of HIV, this 10% translates to every year. That means out of 400 million, some 40 million are likely to develop tuberculosis as a disease every year in their lifetime. But in the presence of HIV, this can be about 40 million every year. So the incidence of tuberculosis disease is about 1.9 million new cases annually, and the prevalence is 3.8 million bacteriologically positive patients. Deaths due to tuberculosis, we say that in every minute about 2 patients die of tuberculosis somewhere. So coming to TB-HIV, there is the other problem which we are facing. About 2.5 million people are infected with HIV, and out of this about 1 million are co-infected with HIV and tuberculosis. So in these patients they have a 10% annual risk of developing active tuberculosis. And now we have the problem of multidrug resistant tuberculosis. In new TB cases, the incidence of multidrug resistance is about 3%, and in retreatment cases, it is as high as 13-17%. And tuberculosis causes a major socio-economic impact because it is usually found in the productive age groups of 15-60 years. So in Chennai, the program has been in vogue from the year 1999, and till the end of 2010, we have examined about 4.6 lakh chest symptomatics, and we have detected about 26,000 sputum positive patients. So Chennai has about 26,000 sputum positive cases, and out of this, we have been able to convert about 23,000 patients. So these were the number of patients put on DOTS. And these are the patients who have completed or either cured by the DOTS strategy. So coming to the scientific basis of DOTS, so as the main problem in RTCP is acceptance, because many of us do not accept these bases. But to understand the DOTS strategy, there are 5 basic concepts which we have to understand. The first is why sputum has been taken up for the strategy. Why we are giving a domiciliary treatment, what is short course chemotherapy, what is intermittent chemotherapy, and what is directly observed treatment. So coming to sputum microscopy, as we all know, we all have different methods of diagnosis of tuberculosis. We can do a sputum, we can do a chest x-ray, we have CT scans and so many methods, serological diagnosis for tuberculosis. But the program has chosen sputum microscopy because, as I already told you, 83% of transmission of tuberculosis is by the sputum positive patients. So from public health point of view, it is important for us to have an early diagnosis of these sputum positive cases and treat them. Because as I told you, a single sputum positive patient can infect another 10 to 15 patients in a year. So if you are able to have an early diagnosis of sputum these patients, we can have a quick control of the disease. So sputum, it provides an easy diagnosis. It is easy to perform. So you don't need any specialized facilities for doing a sputum examination. It is replicable. It is very cost effective, and out of all the patients of tuberculosis, about 50% of patients are sputum positive, and 90% of cases of tuberculosis can be diagnosed by sputum examination alone. The false positivity rate is very low. So coming to X-ray as for the diagnosis of tuberculosis, so this is a study which was done in NTI Bangalore, where you can see that there is a gross over-diagnosis of tuberculosis when it is diagnosed by X-ray alone. Because an X-ray cannot tell us whether it's a previous or a present infection with tuberculosis. But X-ray still has a role in the program. So it is used as a complementary tool. So whenever there is a patient who has chest symptoms for more than 2 weeks, we usually give them, we subject them to a sputum examination. If it is negative, then we give them a course of a broad spectrum antibiotic which doesn't have a tuberculosis activity, like cotrimoxazole. And at the end of 14 days, we repeat the sputum examination. If still you have a doubt, you still think that the patient has tuberculosis, you can always do an X-ray. And the final judgment is the clinicians. If you still feel that the patient is having tuberculosis, you can always treat the patient. So other diagnostic tests for tuberculosis, MANTO, it gives an evidence of infection but not a disease. ESR is non-specific. Culture and sensitivity is very costly and needs specialized labs. Serological diagnosis is actually it's not recommended by the WHO because it has not been standardized. So what is the basis of domiciliary treatment? So domiciliary treatment has been invoked from the year 1956 from the study in Chennai. So they found that domiciliary treatment was as effective as sanatorium treatment, and there is no benefit by rest or specialized diets. Risk for contact is the same. Most patients do not require hospitalization, and economic burden on the society is less. So these were the basis for the domiciliary treatment for tuberculosis. So short course chemotherapy. So many of us would like to treat tuberculosis for a very long time, but there are a lot of studies which show that short course chemotherapy is effective for tuberculosis. By short course chemotherapy, we mean tuberculosis which is treated for less than 9 months duration. So there have been various studies which have been conducted from DRC Chennai between the years 1968 to 87, and they found that short course chemotherapy provides favorable results for all patients. It prevents the emergence of drug resistance. It is convenient and economical. It can be given in the DOTS strategy, and there is improved patient compliance. So these are the reasons for giving a short course chemotherapy. Intermittent chemotherapy. So in RNTCP, we treat patients on a thrice weekly basis. This is based on the concept of lag period. The lag period is that when a culture of bacterium is exposed to a peak concentration of a drug, there is a period in which there no growth of the bacteria occurs. So based on various studies, they have found that if you give this tuberculosis treatment even for 2 days in a week, it is sufficient to prevent the growth of bacteria. So, but in the program, we are giving it for 3 days, so that even if the patient misses a single day of treatment, still he will receive 2 doses in the week, which is sufficient for controlling the disease. So, need for directly observed treatment. As we all know, any patient on self-administered treatment, he usually defaults on treatment. And it is not possible to predict which patient will default. It is not based on the educational status or the socioeconomic status. So DOTS is necessary in initial phase of treatment to ensure compliance and sputum conversion. The main aim of DOT is that even if the patient defaults on the single dose of treatment, he can be traced by the DOTS provider and brought back for the treatment. So coming to the evolution and organization of RNTCP. So as we know, from 1962 to 1993, we had a program known as the National Tuberculosis Program, where the program was based on active case finding by using the MMR, that's mass miniature radiography. So this program was reviewed in the year 1992, and they found that only 30% of patients could be diagnosed, and out of these, only 30% were treated successfully for tuberculosis. So because of this, in 1993, the RNTCP pilot project was begun, and by 1998, it was started to cover the entire country. In 2006, we covered the entire country by RNTCP. So it's a 5-point strategy. So the first is political and administrative commitment. As we all know, no program can run without funds. Okay, so that is why we need a political and administrative commitment. The diagnosis is by sputum microscopy. So we have taken up sputum examination as the main method of diagnosis for tuberculosis. We need an adequate supply of short course chemotherapy drugs, directly observed treatment, and accountability. These are the 5-point strategy for DOTS. So coming to the goals and objectives of RNTCP. So the goal of this program is to decrease mortality and morbidity due to tuberculosis and to cut the transmission of infection until TB ceases to be a major public health problem in India. So that's why we are concentrating on the mainly on the sputum positive cases, which are mainly responsible for the transmission of the infection in the community. So the objectives were to achieve and maintain a cure rate of at least 85% among new sputum positive cases, and to achieve and maintain a case detection rate of 70% of estimated new sputum positive patients. So recently we have revised this target, and from last year we are aiming for 90% of cure rate and 90% case detection. So coming to case detection in RNTCP, so in any institution OP, you can see that about 2% of the new adult OP has patient with cough of more than 2 weeks duration. So these are taken as TB suspects, and any patient with cough of more than 2 weeks duration and with the following symptoms like pain loss, chest pain, shortness of breath, fever or hemoptysis, these patients are subject to sputum examination. So extrapulmonary tuberculosis, the symptoms differ on the site of involvement. So whenever tuberculosis is suspected, we subject the patient to 2 sputum smear examinations, and if 1 or 2 sputums are positive, we treat them as sputum positive tuberculosis. If they are negative, like I told you, we give them antibiotics for a period of 10 to 14 days, usually an antibiotic which has no tuberculosis activity like cotrimoxazole, and if cough persists, we repeat the sputum examination. And if it is still negative, then you can do a chest X-ray, and if you still feel it is tuberculosis, then you can always treat the patient for tuberculosis. So in pediatrics, we follow the same algorithm, except here we take failure to thrive as a symptom of tuberculosis. So diagnosis of pulmonary tuberculosis in RNTCP is based on the sputum examination. We collect 2 sputum specimens. One is a spot specimen on the first visit, and the second is an early morning collection on the next day. So this is a typical square positive tuberculosis. You can see the red shaped bacilli against a blue background. So extrapulmonary tuberculosis, the diagnosis is based on culture positivity or histological or radiological evidence, and by MO's decision to treat by a full course of anti-tuberculosis treatment. So this is the highlight of this program. So if you, because there are many situations in which we cannot definitely prove, but then it is tuberculosis, like CNS tuberculosis. But if the specialist feels that it is tuberculosis, you can always treat them. So the treatment in RNTCP, the main aim of treatment is to ensure a relapse-free cure by preventing the emergence of drug resistance. So here each term is important. You should prevent relapse, you should ensure a cure, and you should prevent the emergence of drug resistance. So in RNTCP, the responsibility of cure has been shifted from the patient to the health system. We have standardized short course regimens, and adherence is ensured through a motivated doc provider, and effective patient retrieval mechanism is there. The aim of this program is, we all know that there are so many regimens for tuberculosis, each of us has their own regimen. But the program aims for providing a standardized regimen so that everyone will have some uniformity in the treatment of tuberculosis. So who is a doc provider? A doc provider is any person who is accessible and acceptable to the patient, and he has to be accountable to the health system. So his job is to supervise, support and promote adherence to treatment. So these are the regimens which we follow in RNTCP. So previously we had 3, now we have only 2 regimens. One is for new patients. All new patients, they are treated with 2 months intensive phase of 4 drugs thrice weekly, followed by 4 months continuation phase with 2 drugs. And in previously treated patients, we treat them for a period of 8 months. So the first 2 months has 5 drugs including streptomycin, and followed by 1 month without injection. This is known as the intensive phase, followed by 5 months of continuation phase. So the idea of giving intensive phase, so many drugs in intensive phase, is for achieving the rapid killing of bacilli. So usually when we use 4 drugs for treating patients in intensive phase, the patients become non-infectious at the end of 2 weeks of treatment. And we can become more than 90% of cases, the sputum conversion occurs by 2 months. There's a quick relief of symptoms, and we can prevent the emergence of drug resistance. These are the ideas of using the 4 drugs in the intensive phase of treatment. In continuation phase, we aim to kill the remaining bacilli. So here what we do is we are giving only INH and rifampicin for killing the persisters. So this is how the boxes are in RNTCP, you have a individual box for each patient. Here you can see the patient's name written on it and the date of starting treatment. So this box, which costs about 5,000 rupees, it's meant for an individual patient. So inside the box, you have your medicines for the intensive phase and for the continuation phase. So now RNTCP has started to cover pediatric population also in association with the pediatric association. So here we have different weight bands for the pediatric patients. And based on the weight bands, we have boxes for them also. So this is the code for the weight banded boxes for the various different weight bands. So for adult population of less than 30 kgs, we can use the pediatric weight band boxes also. So this is the implementation of DOTS in the field for inpatients and even in the slums. So in moments, what we do is in any patient who has been diagnosed with tuberculosis, we refer them to the voluntary health center for doing HIV testing. It's done on a voluntary basis, and if they are positive, then we can initiate them on ARP and we give them cotrimoxazole prophylaxis for these HIV positive TB patients. So what is drug resistant tuberculosis? So drug resistant tuberculosis is a lab diagnosis. It is a man-made tragedy because of using inadequate dosage, inadequate duration of therapy. And this is how drug resistant is defined. So a patient in whom TB is due to tuberculin bacillus, which is resistant to at least one anti-tuberculosis drug, according to accredited methods in the RNTCP accredited lab. So the highlight of this is this statement. The drug resistance, you cannot take results from any external lab. Only if the lab is accredited by the RNTCP and it is done by an accredited method, then it is taken into consideration. So metadrug resistance is defined as resistance to both INH and rifampicin with or without resistance to other drugs. Now we have the problem of extensive drug resistance also. So extensive drug resistance is defined as resistance to INH, rifampicin, one fluoroquine alone, and at least one of the three injectables, that is amikacin, kanamycin or capremycin. So the main way to address drug resistance is by prevention. So here prevention is more important than the cure. If you have a good DOTS program in place, it can prevent the emergence of drug resistance. So in DOTS, we have treatment for drug resistant tuberculosis also. Here the treatment is for 24 to 27 months. And the main problem is that it is 200 times more costly. Where this category 1 box, it costs 5,000 rupees. In DOTS, for treating drug resistant cases, you have to spend at least 1 lakh rupees for these patients. And here the cure rate is also less. So a patient who is treated with category 1 has a 85% chance of cure. A patient treated with category 2 has a 50% chance of cure. Whereas a patient who is treated with for this drug resistant tuberculosis, he has less than 30% chance of cure. So this is the regimen which we used. I will go into that. So the best way to control FDR, XDR, TB is to treat them properly for the first time using DOT strategy. So is it possible for you to help us? So any patient who has cough for more than 2 weeks, we should refer for a sputum microscopy. This slide shows the success rate with the DOTS. This was what was the success rate when we had the National Tuberculosis Program. So till 92, we had a treatment success rate of about 25%. Since the initiation of DOTS, we have an 84% success rate. And the death rate has come down from 29% in the National Tuberculosis Program to less than 4% using the DOTS strategy. So DOTS is the only strategy which ensures cure. And we request you to join us to help us to achieve the goals of RNTCP. So this is the logo. Pura course, Pakka Ilaaj. If you take a full course of treatment, your cure is assured. This was a slide I saw it. Someone shared it with me on Facebook. So when a virus, that is HIV, and a bacteria can work so well together, why can't we? Thank you.